Hello friends, welcome back to channel NEET Biology Expert. I am Dr. Parveen. From this session, we are going to start the next unit of class 12 biology, that is genetics and evolution. So in this unit, genetics and evolution, we have three important chapters. The first chapter is principles of inheritance and variation, in which we are going to study about Gregor Johann Mendel, his contribution and his laws of inheritance. The second chapter is about molecular basis of inheritance, in which we will study DNA, RNA like this and different experiments using that. And third chapter is about evolution, in which we are going to study about different theories of evolution. Right. So let's get start the first chapter, principles of inheritance and variation. Have you ever wondered why elephants give birth to only baby elephant, not any other animal species? Have you ever wondered why rose plant produce only roses, not any other type of flowers? Have you ever wondered why ducklings look same like their parents? Not only birds, animals, plants, insects, like all every organisms, when they reproduce their young ones, they look like their parents. Sometimes, if you have noticed, in a family, there will be siblings, right? So sometimes the siblings look alike. Sometimes they will be completely different. Sometimes the character of the children will be same as their parents. Sometimes the character will be completely different. So why all these similarities and variations exist? What is the reason for this? So like this, there are such related questions dealt with a branch of science called genetics. So what is genetics? Genetics is the study of heredity or inheritance. It is a branch of science which deals with the mechanisms of inheritance or the transmission of the characters from the parents to the offsprings. So genetics is a branch of biology which deals with exactly how the characters are transmitted from parents to the offsprings, or it is transmitted from generation after generation. So that is called as genetics. The term genetics was coined by William Bateson. He is William Bateson. He coined the term genetics in the year 1906. So basically, when we see genetics, genetics deals with two important things. One is heredity and another one is variation. So heredity and variation together is called as genetics. So first, what is heredity? Heredity is the transmission of the characters or the traits from parents to their offsprings. So the characters from the parents is transmitted to the next generation, to the offsprings. So this is called as heredity. Then, what is inheritance? Inheritance is the process by which the characters are passed from the parents to the offsprings. Okay. So, heredity is the transmission of character, and inheritance is the process, is the route, the way through which the characters are transmitted. So, 90% heredity and inheritance, they mean the same thing. So, if you say exactly, inheritance is the basis for the heredity. So, what is variation? Variation is the degree by which the progeny differs from their parents. So sometimes if we see, not 100% the characters of the parents will be transmitted to their offsprings. Sometimes there will be a variation. Okay. So genetics involves both heredity and variation. So from as early as 8000, 2000 BC, human beings, they knew that one of the causes of the variation is something present in their sexual reproduction. That means organism which execute sexual method of reproduction, they show variation. That's why the people in the olden days, they used to breed animals. They used to make a crossbreeding between the plants with different varieties, because they know that variation will be there. Okay. So one of the example for that is a Sahiwal cow. Sahiwal cow is the best dairy breed which is available now in India and Pakistan. This Sahiwal cow is originally a breed from Zebu cow. Okay, so Zebu cow is breeded into a variant variety called Sahiwal cow. So like this, our ancestors know that by crossbreeding the animals, by crossbreeding the plants, we get a superior variety. But exactly, they don't know how it occurs. Okay, how this method occurs, or what is the scientific reason for this phenomena. So then that time came Gregor Johann Mendel. So Gregor Johann Mendel was the first geneticist who unraveled the mystery of heredity. So during the mid 19th century, Gregor Johann Mendel, he was the headway for the genetics in understanding how the inheritance of the characters will be. So he conducted hybridization experiments using garden pea plants for almost 7 years, and he gave, or he proposed, the laws of inheritance in the living organisms. So the contributions of Gregor Johann Mendel to the field of genetics is called as Mendelism. This is called as Mendelism. So what and all Mendel discovered and he contributed to the field of genetics, that is together called as Mendelism. Okay, we can say Mendelian concepts are the basic for the now what we are using, that is modern genetics. That's why we call Gregor Johann Mendel as the father of genetics. Let us understand who is Mendel. Gregor Johann Mendel was born on 22nd July in 1822 in Austria. He studied basically physics and mathematics. He belonged to a poor family. His parents were farmers. So he could not able to continue his study. So he entered a monastery at St. Thomas at Brunn in Austria, where he joined as a priest. So 7 years, from 1856 to 1863, these are the important years in the field of biology, we can say. So 7 years, he did plant hybridization experiments using pea plants. When he was working as a priest in the monastery, he was given the in charge to take care of the garden surrounding that monastery. Okay, so this is the big garden which was under Mendel's in charge. So since his parents were a farmer, he had the interest in cultivating plants. So in this garden only, he started doing his experiments. So this place is called as Mendel's garden. Mendel cultivated pea plants in his garden, and he did the hybridization experiments, that is crossing experiments, using almost 24,000 varieties of pea plants in his garden. So as a result of this, he discovered the principles of heredity, and he proposed all his discoveries as laws of inheritance. The discoveries of Mendel's were published in a title called Experiments on Plant Hybrids in the Proceedings of Brunn Society of Natural History in the year 1866. So in the year 1866, Mendel published all his discovery under the name Experiment on Plant Hybrids. So whatever experiments he did using the pea plants, he himself wrote down all the results, calculations like this, clearly handwritten, and he documented and he proposed this law of inheritance. So we can say Mendel was the first systematic researcher in the field of genetics. Though Mendel did enormous contribution and gave the laws of inheritance and different laws of heredity, his work was not acceptable. His work was not recognized in his duration, in his time period. So what are the different reasons for the non-recognition of Mendel's work? The first reason was he was a monk, not a scientist. He was working as a priest in a monastery. So the biologists did not accept his work. The second reason was he basically studied physics and mathematics. He was not a biologist. So people was not ready to accept whether he did a clear experiment, his research was acceptable, like that. There was a confusion because he was not a biologist. And third reason was his work was not published properly. So Mendel published his work only in the Austrian local journal. So that was a major drawback. Also, the scientists during his period were much interested in the Charles Darwin's theory of evolution. So what Mendel said, that is theory of inheritance, was just opposite to Darwin's theory of evolution. So people were not ready to accept this new concepts. Mendel's theory of inheritance says that there is something called factor, a minute particle called factor, which is responsible for the transmission of the characters from the parents to the offsprings, or the factor is responsible for the inheritance of the characters generation after generation. So Mendel was telling something is there which is responsible for the transmission of the character. So he could not able to explain what is that something. Okay, so he just denotes something as factor. So that's why we say Mendel's theory as particulate theory also. Particulate theory. Okay, particulate theory, because he says that some minute particle is responsible for the transmission of the character. So that factor is what we say as gene. So he could not able to explain or could not able to convince the scientist present during his time. So these were the major reasons for the non-recognition of the Mendel's work during his time. So finally, in 1884, Gregor Johann Mendel, he died. So until his death, nobody was there to recognize his contribution, his discoveries during his lifetime. Then what happened? All his discoveries were kept like that. Whatever he published, it was kept like that. Then in the 20th century, that means after 16 years after Mendel's death, three scientists, they independently rediscovered Mendel's experiments. They did the same work without knowing each other. Okay, they did the work in the year 1900. So those three scientists are Hugo de Vries, who was a Dutch botanist, Karl Korens, a German geneticist, and Erich von Teschenmarck, an Austrian botanist. So these three scientists, they rediscovered, they did the same experiment how Mendel did using his pea plants, and they found the results were amazing. Okay, so they expand the awareness of the Mendelian law of inheritance in the scientific world later. So whatever Mendel did was a huge discovery. So what he said as the factor is now what we call as genes. So genes are the units which are responsible for the transmission of the characters from one generation to next generation. So like this, Mendel's discovery were rediscovered by this three scientists. So let us see what are the reasons for the successful Mendel's work. So though Mendel was not able to convince his co-fellows or the scientists fully during his period, but later scientists found that many of the interesting criteria were found in the Mendel's experiment. So which were the reasons for his success? So what are the reasons for the Mendel's successful research? The first one is meticulous planning and method of work. So his planning was very much accurate, and his method of work, the protocol how he did for the research work was very much clear. So if we cross these plans, if the results is like this, and what will be the outcome? If the result is not like this, what will be the next step I have to do? Like this, he planned very much accurately. The protocol was very much clear. The next one is he used large sample size, more than 24,000 varieties of pea plants he used. So using a large sample size is very much important to give an accurate scientific data and the calculations. So accordingly, Mendel used large sample size. And third reason was he used seven contrasting characters of the pea plants. So he chose the pea plants with seven different contrasting characters, and none of the characters has linkage genes. They were not overlapping with each other. So that was a major reason for his success. And though he chose seven characters, he studied one character at a time. He didn't confuse all the characters together. He clearly studied one character at a time. He completed the study and then he took the next character like this. Like this, his planning was very much clear. And the next reason was he used all the possible tools or all the methodologies to avoid cross-pollination in the pea plants. So when he did cross-breeding between the plants, he completely avoided cross-pollination by the unwanted pollen grains of his parent plant. So that was a major reason. And he applied all the biostatistics and mathematical logistic skills in his experiment. So Mendel was the first person who properly used mathematics and statistics in a biology research. He followed and proved the scientific methods, and he kept quantitative data analysis. His data analysis was very much accurate and in detail. So as I told, he wrote by himself all the what are the different data he got. Like this, his analysis was very much accurate. So these were the different reasons for the Mendel's successful research. Let us see why Mendel chose pea plant. So the pea plant shows clear contrasting characters which is easily identifiable. Either if you see the height of the plant or the color of the flower, the size of the pods, color of the pods, like this, different clear contrasting characters are present in the pea plant. That is one main reason. The second one is the lifespan of the pea plant is short. So he could able to grow the plant quickly and he could complete many experiments in a short period of time. That was a major reason. And third, the number of the seeds produced in the pea pods is more, right? So when we see a pea plant, pea pod, the number of the seeds is more. So in one generation, if he gets a seeds when he plant, so every seed will turn into a plant. So the experiments will be much easier, right? More number of seeds produced by the pea plant. Another important reason is the pea plant can be self-pollinate or it can be cross-pollinated also. Okay, that is a major reason. Also, the size of the flowers are huge, so it is easy to cross-pollinate the pea plants. So these are the major reasons why Mendel chose the pea plant for his experiments. So this table is highly important. This table speaks about the seven contrasting characters what Mendel used. Okay, so the first character is flower color. So whether the plant has purple color or white color, that is the first character. The second character is, what is the height of the plant? Whether the height is tall or the plant is short. We can say short as a dwarf also, okay? So this is the second character. Third character is, what is the color of the seed? Whether it is yellow or it is green. Third one. Fourth is, what is the shape of the seed? Whether it is a round shape or wrinkled shape. Okay. Fourth character. Fifth character is, what is the color of the pod? What is pod? Pod is the covering of the seeds. Okay. So, what is the, this is pod. What is the color of the pod? Whether it is green or yellow in color. This is the fifth character. Sixth character is, what is the shape of the pod? Whether it is fully inflated like this or whether it has constrictions like this. Okay, this is constricted. So shape of the pod is the sixth character. And seventh character is the position of the flower. Whether the flower is located in the axil position like this or in the terminal position like this. So these are the seven different contrasting characters Mendel chose for his experiments. So here, for example, if we talk about the color of the flower as a purple, we mention here as capital P. Capital P means the color of the flower is purple. Okay. So this is the dominant character. Suppose if the color of the flower is white, then we don't say here W. Instead, we denote this as a small p. Okay. So capital P means the color of the flower is purple and small p means the color of the flower is white. We should remember this. So we use capital letter for the dominant character and the same letter we mention in the small letters for the recessive character. This is how exactly Mendel did during his experiments also. So we are following the same thing, right? So for example, let us talk about the height of the plant. If you say the plant is tall, then we use the letter capital T. Similarly, when we talk about if the plant is dwarf or short, we don't say S short, okay? We say small t, okay? And again, for example, the shape of the seed, if it is round, we say capital R. If it is wrinkled, we write this as a small r. So like this, dominant characters are denoted in capital letters and recessive characters are denoted in small letters. Right, what is a dominant triad and recessive triad? That we must understand, right? So, in a sexually reproducing organisms, we have diploid chromosome. That means the chromosomes are paired. So, we have one chromosome from each parent, one from the father and one from the mother, right? So, here in the chromosomes, we have something called allele. So, what is an allele? Allele is a pair of genes that appear at a particular location on a particular chromosome. Allele, they control the same characteristics. So let us understand using this picture, okay? So this is a chromosome, a pair of chromosome. So one chromosome is from one parent and another chromosome is from another parent, right? So suppose we have a gene for a particular character. The genes are present in the same location in both the chromosomes. They are called as alleles. So say when we are talking about the shape of the seed, the shape of the seed, whether it is round or wrinkled, round or wrinkled, okay? So the gene which encodes whether the seed must be round or wrinkled, it is present in one particular position in this chromosome. So in the same position, it is also present in the next chromosome. So this is called allele. Okay. So if both the alleles now represents the seed must be round, that means if they are dominant, then we say this is a homozygous allele. Homozygous allele. Then the shape of the seed will be a round shape. Okay, this is one option. The second option is, the alleles are present. One allele denotes that the shape of the seed must be wrinkled. Okay, but the next allele denotes that the shape of the seed as round. So one is saying round and one is saying wrinkled. So which will be expressed? The dominant character will be expressed. So here the alleles are heterozygous. Heterozygous. So when they are heterozygous, only the dominant character, that is the round shape of the seed, will be expressed. The third option is, two alleles are present, both are denoting the same characteristic, that is the seed shape to be wrinkled. So since both are homozygous, when two alleles are homozygous and they are recessive, okay, so the recessive only will be expressed. That means the seed will be wrinkled. So this condition is called as homozygous homozygous recessive. Recessive. Okay, so here you must understand, in homozygous condition, in homozygous condition, we have two things: homozygous dominant and homozygous recessive. Okay, but in the heterozygous, we don't have dominant or recessive, only dominant will be expressed. Okay, only in the homozygous, we say homozygous dominant or recessive. So this is dominant and recessive triads. So like this, Mendel used this seven different characteristics of the plants with the contrasting character, dominant triad and recessive triad, and he did his pea plant experiments. Also, Mendel, when he did his experiments, hybridization experiments, he initially used all pure breeding plants. So what is pure breeding lines or true breeding lines? What is the meaning for this? So true breeding plants or pure breeding plants means the plants which has only one specific characteristics for several generations, that is called true breeding plants. Okay, so how this is that the plants with a specific characteristic will be undergone self-continuous pollination for several generations. For example, if we want only tall plants, so we take only tall parents and cross this with tall parents. Both the parents are homozygously dominant tall. So as a result of this cross, we get all the hybrids, F1 generation, all the hybrids will be tall plants only. So again, we are crossing two plants from the first generation. Both will be tall. So again, the next generation, all the plants will also be tall in nature. Okay. Again, we choose two plants from the second generation crossing it. The next generation plants will also be tall. So like this, we are choosing one particular character and making a self-breeding or inbreeding between this one generation. So as a result, the character will be remained throughout this generation. Okay, so this is called true breeding plants. So like this, Mendel, he did true breeding plants, 14 different varieties. 14 true breeding pea plant varieties he initially did, and then he started doing his experiments. Okay, so for example, when we talk about the stem height, he took two contrasting characters in the stem height, one plant as tall and one plant as dark. So when we talk about flower color, he took two contrasting characters, so violet color, white color. So like this, seven characters and 14 total different varieties. So he did pure breeding of 14 different varieties of the plants, and then he started doing his experiments. So let us basically understand how Mendel did his breeding experiments. Okay, so first what he did, he took first a pure breeding plants. Then what he did two things. The first one, masculation, and second one is cross-pollination. What is emasculation? So suppose if this purple color flower is a purple female flower. Okay, so this we want to cross-pollinate now with a white male flower. White male flower. So how to do this? First, take the female parent, that is the purple color flower, and just cut out the male part, cut out the anther. So removing the anther from the female part is called as emasculation. So this is the first step, done. Okay, now this female has only stigma. The second step is taking a white male flower parent and taking this anther which contains the pollen grain and transferring this anther artificially into the stigma of the violet colored flower. Okay, so this step is the cross-pollination. This is the second step. So emasculation and cross-pollination, these were the two steps done. So now what will happen? Pollination, fertilization, everything will occur. So as a result of that, pea pods will be produced. So now we have, suppose say, six seeds in this pod. Okay, so all the seeds, now what Mendel is doing, he is sowing the seeds. So from each seed, he is getting only purple color flower. That means all the six seeds are giving rise to only purple color flower. So as a result of this experiment, crossing between a purple color flower with a white color flower, all the six plants now are producing purple color flowers. This is one cross hybridization experiment. So here you could see he used pea plant as the major plant because it has more number of seeds. So all the six seeds, we can able to see the results simultaneously. Okay, so this is a major advantage why Mendel used pea plant for his experiments. So out of the Mendel's experiment, he proposed the laws of inheritance, how the characters are transmitted from the parent to the next generation. He told something as factor. So those factor is what now we identified as gene. So what he said is exactly gene, chromosome, DNA. So this Mendel's insights into this mechanism of inheritance plays a major important role. So as a result of his discoveries, we could able to do improved crop varieties. We could able to do crop hybridizations, like this many things. Okay. So for all these things, what we are doing for the modern genetics, the basic insight is given by Gregor Johann Mendel. So that's why we call Johann Mendel as the father of genetics. So I hope this session is clear for you. Our next session will be about the important terminology used in genetics. If you like this lesson, like, comment, share and subscribe to our channel, Neat Biology Expert. Thank you.